Thanks for having me here. Just got off an airplane, so maybe a little jet lag, so give me a few minutes to get the juices flowing. So I want to talk a little bit about today about how we can use user experience to help reduce unconscious bias or bias in the technologies that we do every day. So a little bit about myself, that's kind of been a cover, but we love using emojis to kind of highlight our bio and what we do. From the sunny state of Florida, born and raised, so very far from here. Also love all things technology, and that's why I really like talking about this topic around technology, user experience, and bias, is that I love this stuff, and I want it to be for me and all of us here, too. Love all things sports. Have a 3-year-old that drives me crazy and likes creeping in the bed at night, kind of like Children of the Corn, kind of creepy when the door opens. You don't see anybody, and then like the head pops up, like it's a little creepy. Do user experience design at General Assembly, and it's really great to come work with students and helping them figure out their path in this world of user experience. So I think we've talked a lot about bias today. I'll focus less on the bias part, more on the user experience side, so we can focus on strategies and things that we try to share with our clients and what we do within our company to really kind of reduce the effect of bias in the work and creating innovation. Oh, thank you. So unconscious bias, I think we all know what that is. But it was really great. It's how we want to talk a little bit more specifically of how, as practitioners, we allow by our own personal bias to affect the work that we do in terms of what we design, how we implement technology, but also as we look at it from the other lens of we have users and customers that may use our platform and may interact with other customers and users, and how do we reduce the bias between the interactions that we allow happen on our platforms. So I'm going to show a few examples throughout this process of kind of talking through this. And a lot of these examples are really things that we found on the web. I didn't like make this up. These are like real screenshots from real things. And so this is the first one I think what we talk about a lot when we're working with companies is that it's easy for the people doing the work not to think outside themselves. And they easily put together a form like this around gender, but don't think about the consequences of what they put on the screen. And so really thinking about being intentional about the work that we do as user experience designers, really forcing ourselves to really think outside of just, I have a requirements list. My PM told me to put together a gender form, and I'm just gonna throw some stuff on it and say done. But it requires more work than that, it requires more thought, that we're not creating experiences that are gonna turn people away or create offenses that may either cost effect to revenue, some really angry emails to people in the company or press that's negative press about how we're not thoughtful about different populations. The other idea that we printed in here, because for many of us, like if I'm a male, I'm always used to seeing a male option. So it's so easy that to think only in the frame of reference of your own perspective, particularly being, as we're looking at just the simple things that we see every day on web applications. Gender forms, emails, first name, last names, even the first name field. We were working with a group at ASU, and the dean had a two-part first name, but she couldn't put her two-part first name into the first name field. Those are kind of things that turn not just deans away, but turns away potential students and things like that because they can't actually fill out the application to go to that university. So really being thoughtful, and that's why I want to spend a little bit more time today thinking about how we approach and come up with tactics to reduce the effect of our own biases as we're creating experiences. So a little exercise that we like to do. I know we're all aces when it comes to addressing our own bias, but I want to just stretch the bias muscles a bit and just kind of really just, let's all role play a little bit. So you can look at the screen, look at the apps on the screen, and you can start using your bias muscles to start figuring out, or at least putting some categories around who you think this person may be. You know, you may start thinking about, based upon the application, you see what gender they may be, what jobs they may have, are they knowledgeable in technology? But we use our bias muscles to start creating buckets, and we'll look at, and we use technology a lot of times to actually start creating those buckets, particularly as we're creating user personas. We'll say, these types of users have this type of literacy when it comes to technology, or they tend to like these types of things. And we do these kind of generalizations and categorizations when it comes to starting to divide our market, who's our market, who's our target customers. Really thinking about and that our biases are driving our assumptions. And the biases when our team drives our assumptions of who our target users are and what their motivations are. So if you took a little time to think about who, you don't have to share it, but if you have in your mind who you think this person is my beautiful wife. And but from her app, you may not fully get that's who she is because she has ESPN. You may not always assume that women love ESPN, but she loves sports. But the thing is, I think that's where, as we were thinking about user experience design, how we need to stretch ourselves, that we, even when we're doing our work, it's so easy to fall back into the traps of our own unconscious bias around who we think our users are, what we think they like, what we think they enjoy, and that affects how we actually design for them. And then we all have our bias blind spots. As much as we do this work every single day, we still have our own personal biases that will affect the way that we're going to design an app or a screen or the assumptions and motivations that I think the users are going to have. So I think many of us may have already taken the implicit bias test, but I really try to push this for even our own teams, just for all of us to be very aware of where our weaknesses are as we're working together as a team, so that then we can start working more implicitly and less unconsciously. So more examples. So we had one particular client that was developing an app. We were working with them to develop an application to kind of do on-demand barbers that come to your home and wherever to kind of give you a haircut. So from their perspective, they're like, all right, there's a group of women of color, we have a pretty good idea of the target market. They're gonna be, African-American men, 20-somethings to 30-something, they're gonna really want this service. And we started pushing them. Say, is there other customers who may not be taking in consideration? And we really kept pushing them. They're like, oh, you're right. Women actually want barbers, or they go to barbers as well because they're looking for precision haircuts. And so even within a group of women of color, they still had their own biases. And so it's so easy to think it's just a certain group that have bias. We all do. And even as we're doing our work, in particular trying to design these experiences, we need to be able to figure out, one, have we pushed out a group of customers that could bring in a lot of revenue for the company? Have we just ostracized a group just because we haven't thought about tailoring experience for them? Because if they would have moved forward with the experience that they wanted to do, there would have been all these male gender pictures, and there would have been all these things that would have turned away women from actually wanting to use this application. So those are the kind of things that we try to push our clients to really push themselves. So now we have activated our unconscious bias. So how do we reduce this bias as we're working on our technology teams? We're working on our project managers, our designers, our developers. How do we get them to flex their kind of bias muscles that they're actually being more thoughtful? And so the first thing you think about when you think about your teams are, what is the makeup of your team? I think we all kind of make an assumption of what these teams look like, but that's obviously changing very rapidly. These teams don't just look like the Silicon Valley show. They look more like this room that we're sitting in now. And so how do we reinforce that what we see here is what's happening in our technology teams? How do we reinforce the diversity in thought and perspectives that will help create a better product? And I believe one of our past speakers talked about diverse teams put out better products. And I see it every day. And so how do we not just, we don't always have control over the technology team we're given, but how do we create an atmosphere where we can become the advocates of how do we push these thoughts forward? So let's talk a little bit about, if you have some ability to affect the makeup of the team, really what we've seen and what we try to push as we're kind of pushing other teams to be more inclusive, what that makeup could be to actually have better inclusion. So a multi-generational team. It's easy for all of us young people to want to exclude the old people. But there's something about having perspective, because we work at one client now that's in aging, and it's so easy that everyone's under 22 in our office to not understand the complexities of low literacy and how that affects creating a user experience. So Also making sure that you have a cross-generational team is really critical to creating inclusive designs. Clicked too far, sorry. That's the jet lag kicking in right now. Extroverts, introverts. Really thinking about, as you're thinking about experiences, the differences between those who are really outwardly, you know, emotional versus the ones who kind of think inwardly, talk to different ways that you may need to commonly put together the experience, because they may approach a user experience very differently. So making sure that you can have a good mix of not just the introverts and extroverts, but a good mix of them in the team. Right brain, left brain seems pretty obvious, but it's so easy that when you're pulling together teams, especially if you have the option to put your team together, you just put together a team full of creatives, and then you don't think about the other side, or the business managers, or the business analyst, and making sure they're being part of the conversation, because there's value in having those different inputs at the table. And obviously, different cultures, different countries, people from different backgrounds obviously bring different things to the table in terms of capturing those mistakes around the first part, you know, two-part first names, or, you know, what if those English isn't their first, you know, language? You know, what do we do in our user experience to take that into consideration? Really making sure that having those different viewpoints will actually help to do that as well. I'm going to jump ahead a little bit because I'll cover a little bit more of these later. I'll make sure I'm keeping up with my time. So a little bit more to the user experience side. We want to make sure that we talked about unconscious bias. Now, how do we think more implicitly, knowing that we have bias? I know that I have weaknesses in certain areas. I know I have certain categories I still struggle with. How is that going to affect me every day, and how do I reduce that in the work that I do? So I want to talk about one example. I know there's Airbnb was kind of in the news for a while about, was we're talking about user-to-user interactions, about reducing bias between the host and people wanting to rent, you know, locations. And so this is one example as we're looking not just at the teams, but looking at, we have applications that allow users to interact with each other, and now we're responsible for reducing the bias between the users and their interactions. And so they started, you know, doing things to actually try to reduce this bias on their platform. So they started doing tests. So they started doing one test where they did pretty much the exact same request, but slightly changed the names of the individuals to actually see if there's different results from the host rejecting or accepting their request. And they saw there was a 16% higher decline, or I guess a rejection of those who had African American sounding names. So there's just a higher percentage of rejection. So what they wanted to do was to start identifying different approaches that they can do to reduce the bias. And so a lot of things that they started doing, they started creating clear communication to the host around reducing bias, but they also start incorporating new tactics into the technology around providing more information. So before it was just an image and a name and a rating, there was more detailed information about the particular host and guest. So then you start getting a better picture of who they were as a person versus just a picture and a name. And those things kind of help provide more context of who they were versus just a name and a picture. And you know, I think the bias muscles really kick in. We just see a name in the picture, but if you actually see a more fuller context of who they are, it reduces some of the bias that happens just knee-jerk as you're just looking through a list of people who are looking to be hosted in your home. So, again, emphasizing a welcoming message from them for all travelers and guests, providing more tools to the host so they can better understand who's coming into the home. So there's just some of their tactics for reducing bias. And I think these are the kind of things as we're thinking about technology and innovation, and we're working with clients building more on-demand applications or building more innovation, that we as the practitioners need to be more thoughtful about how do we foster a community that reduces bias, even in the technologies that we build. This is another example. Let's go back. This is real life screenshots, but this one, if you're not able to see it from a distance, says, have you entered the title for a doctor for a customer that is female? Is this correct? Kind of crazy, but this is one of those things where you may have let the developer just make up the validation rules, and they may not have been very thoughtful. But again, this is where we're something as small as that left out there for a user to experience will turn them away, or be the reason why someone gets a nasty email. So really thinking about, from a development standpoint, how we think about validation rules and how we apply them. Again, as we're looking at the world now, conversational UI and bots and AI, and they're now going off and creating their own conversations, really figuring out, you know, as the practitioners are building these new platforms, how much of a responsibility do we have about reducing the bias that can be generated through these automated bots that are now talking for themselves, and how they learn, and should they learn bias or should they not learn bias? These are things that we need to tackle, relying on as these technologies are coming out. But as we're thinking specifically about the design process, the process that we all go through from discovery, design, develop, deploy, test, this is where we see bias tends to kind of pop up. Is where how we're targeting, you know, what customers are we targeting, how are we profiling our target customers, are there differences, cultural differences in the groups that we're targeting? Should we really be more thoughtful about the cultural differences, and does that affect the user experience that we need to create? And then are the differences so different from the people sitting in the room that we need to do something different to make sure that we better understand the group that we're targeting? And can we just talk to them? And I think a lot of times when you're doing the work, it's so easy not to just talk to your users, but it is as simple as that. The other thing is similar to the pop-up that had the weird validation rule. Bias obviously pops up as we're actually doing the work of development, where we're making assumptions of rules that we create around the users that may actually introduce bias. So obviously validation rules, like we saw before, around, you know, doctor or, you know, two-part first names. Again, also when we're starting to think about user testing itself, do we have a diverse enough pool that's representative for the customer base that we're trying to target? And then also making sure that it's so easy as you're starting to create user personas not to challenge them over time. Because as you're growing a platform, you're going to get more and more customers. And obviously that pool will become more diverse over time. Are your personas keeping up with the diversity of the group that's actually using the platform you've developed? Let's see. In the ideation process, one thing we note, especially as we're going into helping teams, is there's always kind of one dominant person that drives the ideation process. And a lot of times that affects, obviously, with the end product. So it's as we're thinking about this innovation of bias, it's even as important to make sure that we're doing good things in terms of creating an atmosphere for innovation and ideation to happen, in addition to having a diverse team. So really thinking about your approaches to make sure every voice is heard, that voices, the smaller voices aren't pushed out the way by the big dominant voices, but really making sure that you're creating an atmosphere for your team, that every voice is heard, because that one voice may be the one that's telling you not to allow that doctor validation rule for women to pop up. So really thinking about that. It's not just about the diversity team, it's about also everybody's voice being heard within the team. Prototyping is also really critical, and as you're prototyping, there's some pretty obvious things that we want to make sure that we want to have a place to, in terms of having a design that's more inclusive. Obvious things around font sizes, affordances, as we do a lot of work around mobile application, and especially a lot of the application with the more older and aging communities, having larger affordances for senior communities and larger font sizes, or the ability to adjust the font sizes, even in mobile experiences, which is more work for the developers and more work for us as product managers. But if you really want to address your markets, you got to really stretch yourselves. Really thinking about colors that we use, because we've been working a lot, again, in aging, and we've been even surprised, even the usage of colors. And the over usage of colors when we've been working with the aging community, we keep things super simple. I mean, like one or two color palettes. The idea around spacing and clarity around the direction that we want to move them through, because even small distractions can move people with low literacy and move them down the wrong path or confusion to the point they don't want to use the platform. So there's a couple kind of strategies we use even internally to make sure that we're keeping and being honest with ourselves on a daily basis as we're working through these things. So flipping the narrative, something we like to do, and we say it within our company, as if we've been consistently always talking about the type, same type of user, the same type of person. You know, maybe one day let's completely go to the complete opposite spectrum for that person. Maybe they're 18 to 21, let's go to 60. Let's see if someone that's 65 actually will want to use our application. If they do, is there actually real analytics that show that someone that's 65 that wants to use our application? Do they use it? Would there be any challenges? But really, if we've been so stuck in our ways with a particular type of user or market, actually challenging ourselves to look to the extreme and actually see if there's actually some relevant use cases there for groups that may not fall in line with what our usual assumptions are. Challenging the categories. We all have categorized our users in different ways. Really going back and challenging the categories we're placing on them. Are they really who we think they are? And are we really solving the problems we think we're solving? Looking at if our team is really diverse enough to really meet the challenges of the products that we're developing. So really taking the hard look and actually see if do we have diversity in thought, diversity in culture that actually meets the need of the actual group that we're trying to reach. Holding your team accountable. So when you see these bias things show up in the technology work that you do, not letting it just go and be brushed underneath the rug. Actually being the advocate that pushes and says, hey, we actually need to allow two-part first names. This isn't actually acceptable. What's the plan for us to elevate this and not put it at the bottom of the backlog? And so I think it's also our role now as advocates to actually make sure these things, as they show up in the work that we do, that then we advocate that it gets out of it. And using empathy, which is pretty obvious, but it's really more of training our teams to work in a place of empathy and not just to blow off when they get a support ticket and they're like, it seems like a stupid request, to actually really think about, actually, is this really affecting a larger swath of our customer group versus us just blowing it off as, you know, a waste of time or this is just one person's opinion. But really having the whole team work in that perspective from the developers and designers to the business analysts to work from a place of empathy. So kind of in closing, I think it's our job as not just user experience designers, but product owners, developers, people who are working in technology to find ways to reduce our own biases and in the work that we do every single day that reaches so many people. The power of technology is powerfully credible, but it can be powerfully destructive all at the same time. And so making sure that the work that we do every day, that we're being extremely thoughtful, that we're creating experiences that will embrace more people, embrace people who feel like they're being left out, and we're actually making sure that the work that we're doing actually is going to be embraced by everyone. So I thank everyone for their time, and there's some additional resources and links and things. So if you want to find it, I'll put this on SlideShare for all those who want to find it. Yeah.